We're in this series right now called Valuable. And what we're doing is we're taking a look at our church's mission and our core values as a church. You know, what is the DNA? What makes Expectation Church, Expectation Church? And today is actually the last part of that series. We're going to look at our last core value. And the title of that core value is Passion Over Comfort. Now, I will readily confess before you all that this is kind of the one I was saving for last. Not because I think it's best, but because I was kicking the can down the road and procrastinating a little bit. This is one that's not the easiest to talk about. It's a little bit more abstract to understand, but it's also a little hard to get across. Not for the sake of understanding, but because of what it means. Because really what that word passion means is, I know we think, whenever we hear the word passion, like try to think, what comes to your mind when you think of passion? You think of stuff that, you know, you get really passionate about, you get really excited about. And that's okay. I kind of like the fact that that connotation comes to mind. I'm a Cleveland Browns fan. And you cannot be, thank you, Dog Pound. I love it. You cannot be a Cleveland Dogs Pound, a Cleveland Dogs, I'm all over the place, a Cleveland Browns fan. You cannot be part of the Dog Pound. You cannot be a Browns fan unless you're really passionate, because the Browns are really good at giving reasons to their fans to no longer be fans. Believe me, I haven't been a fan for long. I became a Cleveland Browns fan the year they went 1-15. I thought, you know what, that's going to be my team. That's the team that my family, my wife's family, they love that team. So I'm into football now, so I'm going to claim that team as my team also. And they're not doing so great this year. They can't do any worse. And no one's going to blame me for jumping on the bandwagon. So they went 1-15 that year. The next year, that 1-15 means they won one time and lost 15 times. Can't get any worse. The next year, they won 0 times and lost 16 times. Our record was 1-31. We were doing great. Doing great. You remember that's the year we fired Hugh, which is probably a good thing. I like our new head coach quite a bit. We had to get through Freddie first. But then we got to our new head coach, who's an amazing, I like him a lot. Anyway, I'm not here to talk about the Browns. But you can see that I have some passion about the Cleveland Browns. And that's what comes to our mind when we hear the word passion. And so I'm okay with that connotation coming to our mind. But really, the word passion doesn't actually mean to get excited about something. What the word passion means is to love something so much you will suffer for that thing. This is why, you know, we call if you've ever heard of a passion play, it's the story of Jesus Christ going to the cross. The movie that Mel Gibson directed so many years ago, The Passion of the Christ. It's the story of what Jesus went through, of what Jesus suffered for all of us. It's Jesus's passion. It's what Jesus was willing to suffer. So that word passion, what it means is to suffer. Now, I could say, as a Cleveland Browns fan, I do know what it is to suffer. But that's what the word means. It means to suffer for something you love so much. That's a passion. So it's passion over, beyond, above comfort. Now, this is difficult. It was when we were working through these core values, this core value used to be called passion over being comfortable, because that we thought that conveyed kind of more of where we wanted to go, but people just kept truncating it more to passion over comfort, so that's where we've landed, it's where we've stuck. And the reason why that may not be the best way to phrase it, but it's what's sticking, is the fact that when we talk about comfort, like I want you to know the comfort of Jesus Christ. I want you to know that by having faith in Jesus, by giving your life to him, there is an amazing sense, an overwhelming sense of peace and grace and comfort that comes from knowing Jesus. I want you to know that. I want you to believe that. I want you to experience that. When I was in the hospital room with my father dying his last week of life, I had comfort through that whole process because I had Jesus. So I want people to know that comfort that comes from knowing Jesus. So this is why it's kind of hard to get through, because you're saying we shouldn't have comfort. Well, I think especially in 21st century world, and especially 21st century America, comfort is like a really big thing to us. We want to be comfortable. We let comfort dictate our lives. Look, you're a Christian. No, we don't. We certainly do not. Okay, give me an example. We got these young ones down here on the front row. Ariana, I'm gonna pick on you real quick. I know you love that. Ariana, have you ever heard the expression, roll your windows down, like when you're driving in the car? Okay, she said no, okay? Do you know why she said no? I'll explain it. Whenever your parents say, roll your windows down, like you're driving around, they say, hey, can you roll your window down, or can you roll your window up? Kids these days, they don't know why we say the word roll. Well, let me tell you. Way back in the day, there used to be a crank on the door that you had to, this arm that you had to turn around and around and around. And so it was like you were rolling the window up or rolling the window down. And if you had an old car, what you had to do is this two-handed motion where you had to grab the window and pull as you rolled. And now you had to be really careful because if you rolled it up too high, too far, then you couldn't put the thing down. So you had to roll it up so there was a crack at the top so we could get your fingers in there and then help it down as you rolled it down. And then you couldn't roll it all the way down. You needed this that little bit at the top. So you grab it and roll it all the way up. Now we have buttons. And now we've gone beyond that. In both of my vehicles, now it's no longer, you don't even have to push the hold. Just push the button and the window comes down. Just push the button and the window comes up. Why? Because it's far more comfortable. Kids these days will never, ever know the pain of freezing cold weather and vinyl seats. Yeah, see? And the kids are kind of like, I don't even know what he's talking about. Cars used to have vinyl seats in them. No, not, oh yeah, ours has leather. No. Vinyl. And what would happen when it would get really, really cold is the vinyl would turn into sharp blades. And you would sit down on it and the vinyl would get like these folds or creases that would just stick into your legs. It felt awesome. And then in the hot weather, vinyl got even worse because you would get stuck to it. And when it was time to get out of the vinyl car, you would have to unpeel your skin and leave behind several layers of skin on the hot vinyl seats. And a lot of kids are like, that didn't happen. Ask mom and dad. It happened. You know why we don't have vinyl seats anymore, even though they're way cheaper? Comfort. We love being comfortable. We often let comfort dictate our actions. That's why this value is so essential. Our mission statement as a church is very simple. Here's the mission. So that people far from God will experience faith in Christ. That's why it's phrased like that intentionally. This is our why. Why do you do what you do? Why did the church do that? Why? We're not going to do it perfectly, but we always want the answer to our why to be this. Why did you do church that way? So that people far from God will experience faith in Christ. Like I said, we're not going to do it perfectly. We're going to make mistakes. We're going to fail along the way. But this is to be our why. This is what we're striving for. This is our mission so that people far from God will experience faith in Christ. We will never, ever live up to this mission if we let comfort dictate our lives. Instead, it must be our passion for all things Jesus. This is why passion over comfort is a little bit more of a difficult core value to explain, because all of our other core values kind of have very practical application, meeting needs, outward focused, welcome home. They all have, or dependent in prayer. They all have kind of an action step to take. Passion over comfort is not about an action to take. It's about an attitude to have. And the attitude must be passion over our comfort. And we will never fulfill this mission. We will never achieve this why unless we're willing to step into those situations that might be uncomfortable. So this is what passion over comfort means. Passion over comfort is willing to suffer for Jesus. And that's why it's hard to get up on stage and tell people, you should follow Jesus. It might hurt. You know, it's like when you go to my kids, they come to me all the time. Hey, Daddy, it hurts when I do this. What does every parent say? Then don't do that. That's like a duh. You know what else hurts? When you slam your head into a door. So don't slam your head into a door. It's really, really simple. We don't want to do that which hurts. We want to do that which is comfortable for us. We can't fulfill our mission unless we're actually willing to suffer for Jesus. Now, this isn't me, you know, coming up with this idea. This isn't me saying this is where I think we should be. I mean, all of these values, even the mission, all of it, what we did as a team is we looked at really God's word and scripture, and we prayed through these, and I spent a lot of time praying through these. And when you look at the ministry of Jesus Christ, how he lived on mission, how he sought to make disciples, how he sought to reach people who were far from God so that they would experience faith in himself, passion over comfort really defined his attitude throughout his life. And there's a great passage of scripture that we're going to go to explain that. I would encourage, you know, at the title slide, I had Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 28. I'm not going to go through all of those verses, but I would encourage you read that whole section starting at verse 13. Verse 21 in the middle of that says, from that time. So this is why I challenge you to read, go back to verse 13, read what happened. So when you say from that time, so what happened? What's the time? What is that time that we're launching from here? Well, prior to this, what happened was Jesus, he'd been doing his thing, his missionary thing for a long time. And so he gathers his disciples around him and he says, look, guys, we've been doing this for a while. We've been hitting the streets. We've been going into towns. We've been going into villages. We've been telling people the gospel. We've been healing people. We've been doing this for a long time. So after doing all this for a while, what is everybody saying? What's the feedback you guys are getting from people? Who do people say that I am? And his disciples answered. They said, well, some people are saying you're a prophet. Some people saying you're Elijah. Some people saying, and they give various answers. And then Simon Peter is one of the disciples. He's there with Jesus, and Jesus says to his disciples after they give that answer, he says, well, who do you? That's what everybody else says. Who do you say I am? And then Simon Peter steps up to give an answer, and Simon Peter says, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. That was a confession, and that Jesus is the Savior. Jesus is the one that was promised to come and save the Jewish people. And Jesus, when he says Son of the living God, no one else could claim that. He was saying that Jesus is divine, that Jesus is actually God. And Jesus turns to Simon and he calls him Peter. Peter was not his name. Peter was a nickname. What it means is rock. It's like calling him Rocky. And he says, all right, I'm gonna call you Rocky from now on. And it's upon this rock that I'm going to build my church. And now there's a lot of debate out in the world so is he saying that the church is going to be built on Peter? Or is he saying the church is going to be built on the confession that Peter made? And I'm one of these guys that says, yes, it's both. Yes, the church is built on believing and accepting and trusting in Jesus as the Messiah, as the Savior, as Lord, as the Son of God. But Peter, even in the New Testament, he's referred to as a pillar of the church. Peter was one of the founding fathers of the New Testament first church of Jesus. So it's both in that context. But Jesus says to Peter, he says, all right, you know this because God's revealed it to you. No human being revealed this to you. God revealed this to you. So upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. That's what happens prior to verse 21. And so from that time, when it had become just abundantly clear and the disciples had accepted it, that Jesus is Messiah, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must, not might, but he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Now we have to hone in on that word rebuke. One of the best things that you can do whenever you're reading scripture is let scripture interpret scripture for you. So when you see that word, when Matthew uses this word rebuke, the other times that he uses the word rebuke, once is when Jesus, he's in a boat with his disciples and there's this crazy storm and the disciples are freaking out and Jesus stands up and he rebukes the wind and the waves and the storm. He calms them all down. He silences and steadies and settles it all, ends the storm at his rebuke. Another time there's a demon-possessed person and Jesus rebukes the demon out of him. So this is a power word. This is a word of authority. And so what happens is Jesus is with his disciples. He's just had this moment with them where they said, this leader among them, Peter, who had his name changed to Rocky because he's going to be the rock on which the church is built. He has this moment with them where they confess him to be the Messiah. They confess him to be God's son. And then Jesus says, all right, now we're going to go to Jerusalem and I must be killed and I will rise from the dead on the third day. And so then Peter, what he does is, I try to put myself, I don't know if the Bible doesn't say he did this. Well, it kind of says he did. He says, Peter took him aside. I think Peter took Jesus and put his arm around him and said, Jesus, come, let me talk to you for a minute. Look, dude, Peter, don't call Jesus dude, okay? You can't say stuff like that. That will never happen. Never, Lord, he said. This shall never happen to you. This is unthinkable, Jesus. You can't say stuff like that. We will not let this happen to you. And then, this is why you can't, we like to get these thoughts in our mind of Jesus being this like really gentle, cuddly teddy bear kind of figure. Like you can walk up to Jesus and give him a high five. Let's go grab a burger, homeboy. Because you're friendly. Look, I think Jesus was friendly. And I think Jesus was kind and mild and caring. But Jesus was also Jesus, Son of God. And so when Peter rebukes the Son of God about his mission, Jesus doesn't have a very gentle response. He's not like, well, Peter, let's talk about that for a moment. Look at what Jesus says in verse 23. Jesus turned. Now, I think what happened is Peter grabs Jesus and they walk off kind of by themselves in confidentiality and Peter's rebuking Jesus kind of one-on-one. Jesus turns to Peter and I think he publicly, so the disciples could hear and so Peter could hear, Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." I guarantee you, in my 15, 16 years of ministry, I've never said that to anybody. I guarantee you, if I said that to somebody, I would probably get an email. Get behind me, Satan. So can you imagine the whiplash this must have caused for Peter? Here's Peter. Peter, yes, you understand it. You're going to be the rock on which I'm going to build my church. I'm changing your name to Rocky. It's not Simon, it's Peter, it's Rock. You've got it, you understand it, you get it. Get behind me, Satan. He went from Rock to build the church on to Satan in like an instant. Why? Why such the change? Why such a strong rebuke? Jesus tells us why. Right here, you are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. When Peter confessed Jesus to be the Messiah, the Son of the living God, Jesus said, man didn't reveal this to you. God has revealed this to you. Good job. You get it. You've listened to God's thoughts. You've listened to God's concern. You listen to what God is telling you. And then in this moment, Peter has a human moment. And he says, nah, this is never going to happen to you, Jesus. You can't go and die. And then Jesus, that's the reason Jesus is here, is to die for my sins and to die for your sins so that all of the punishment we deserve for our sins could be paid on the cross with Jesus and that we could be saved by his blood and by his grace. And Peter's getting in the way of that. So now it's not a rock on which the church is going to be built. Now it's a rock that's in the way. It's a stumbling block. And so Jesus says, get behind me. Because if the stumbling block is behind you, you're not going to trip over it as long as you're going forward. So Jesus really calls Peter out and says, you're a stumbling block to me. Why are you a stumbling block? Because you do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. I would argue that's what comfort is when we get concerned about the things that will make us comfortable. Peter was made uncomfortable hearing about Jesus dying. And so he rebuked Jesus for it. Jesus called them out. Said, that's not what God wants. That's what the human mind wants. Look at how Jesus continues now as we go to verse 24. Now, he's going to address all the disciples. He just had this very dramatic moment with Peter, and I think they all heard it. So he says, look, guys, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Now, we hear that in our context, in our culture today, and we think, okay, you know, that sounds like, all right, I can do this. It sounds kind of motivating. Because in our minds, in 21st century world now, whenever we hear the cross, we get pictures of, or images or thoughts of forgiveness and grace and mercy. Because that's what the cross means. That's why several people have asked me, Christian, when are we going to get a cross at our church? I want a cross on the building. I want a cross in the auditorium. Because that's what it means. It's a symbol of grace and mercy and forgiveness. I understand that. But to these people, that's not what the cross meant. The cross meant you were guilty of a very heinous crime and you should be canceled. I'm trying to put that into modern context. You should not have your job. In fact, you shouldn't even be alive because of the shameful thing that you did. That's what the cross represented. And so when Jesus tells these guys, you have to deny yourself, deny your comfort, deny the things that make you comfort, and you have to take up the cross. Whoa, the cross? That's shameful. When someone took up the cross, what they had to do is they had to carry this big, heavy crossbeam on their shoulders through the town so that way crowds could come out and jeer them and scorn them because of the shameful thing that they had done. And then they would take that cross and be nailed to a tree with it, naked for the whole world to see, while the whole world mocked and scorned that person for the shameful thing they had done. And this is what it takes to be a disciple of Jesus? Is there like a maybe option? Or a can I, you know, is there a trial period? This is what it takes. Jesus is saying, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me, will find it. See, it's not comfortable to get up and say, all right, Jesus wants us to lose our lives for him. Jesus wants us to be willing to suffer for him. Who wants to suffer? Nobody wants to suffer. I don't want to suffer. Ever. It's not comfortable. I don't want to go through that. And that's exactly what Jesus is calling for from his disciples. That's exactly, I think it's so telling. That's exactly what Jesus himself would go through for us. So I have five principles I'll go very quickly through about what passion over comfort means from this passage of Scripture. The first one's really, really simple. Passion over comfort is about following Jesus. And I don't just mean like being a Jesus follower. I mean literally following Jesus. Jesus would carry his own cross. Jesus would go to the cross and be crucified. This is what Jesus was willing to go through for us. And so if we are going to be disciples, what a disciple is a disciplined follower. We need to be willing to walk the same road. Jesus was willing to step into uncomfortable situations all the time, even if it cost him his life. Jesus would go and he would meet with people who were unclean or people who had diseases or people he would meet with prostitutes and drunks. He would step into uncomfortable situations. Jesus would go without wealth. He would go without a home. He would go without a change of clothes. He would go without so that way he could accomplish the mission that God had given him to do. Well, Christian, does that mean it's wrong if we ever enjoy anything comfortable? Of course not. Of course you can enjoy the power windows that your car has. Cruise control. I love cruise control. I know cruise control used to be a sack of BBs that you would put on the gas pedal, but it's changed now and there's a button that you could press. I love those comforts that we get to enjoy. There's nothing wrong with enjoying the comforts that this world has to offer, but when the comforts that this world has to offer prohibit us from stepping out in the mission that God has called us to, then those comforts are no longer comforts. They're called idols. Jesus stepped into the uncomfortable. Passion over comfort means we follow Jesus into the uncomfortable. Following him, that's what it's all about. Second thing, passion over comfort is not natural. Look, what was natural is what Peter did. Jesus, that's never going to happen. Passion over comfort is supernatural. One of the things that you have to look, and why is it natural? Because we're always going to go towards our own comfort. I get it. But passion is when we're willing to step out of our comfort and into that which might even make us suffer. So it's not natural, but because Jesus said, whoever loses their life for me, whenever we are stepping into the suffering for Jesus, it becomes something supernatural. And the reason it's so supernatural is because of what comes next. We can look through what it means to lose our life. Because passion over comfort, I'll go to the next one. Passion over comfort is about losing your life. And look, I don't want to get up on a stage and say, all right, everybody, go lose your lives. That's a horrible thing to say. Someone's going to say, what kind of Kool-Aid are they serving? Because I've seen those horror stories. Look, Jesus was called and he gave up his life. He had this whole lifestyle of ministry, and then it cost him in the end, and he died on the cross. You may not, the bank account that is your life, God may not call you to write one check and clear it all out in one fell swoop. You may spend that bank account that is your life in dimes and nickels in days. But I'm telling you right now, the call to discipleship, the call that Jesus has on his church is for us to lose our lives for him. It may take an entire lifetime to lose it, but that's the call of our Lord and Savior. Passion over comfort is about losing your life, laying your life down for him, because he laid down his life for us. Well, how are we supposed to do that? How are we supposed to get through that? Now this is the looking through part. Passion over comfort is about looking through. You notice what Jesus said, because lots of times we're just like Peter. We looked at the big thing that resonated with us. We looked at the thing that makes us uncomfortable, death on a cross. Okay, that would make me uncomfortable. And Jesus said, I must go to Jerusalem to be killed, and that made Peter uncomfortable. Peter completely skipped or forgot or neglected what Jesus said after that. Jesus said, I must go to Jerusalem and be killed, and 3 days later I will rise again. Peter lost sight of the resurrection, or he didn't even understand the resurrection. We have to understand that when Jesus calls us to suffer for him, there is a promise at the other end of that suffering. That's why it says in Hebrews, consider him, Jesus, consider him who endured the cross, scorning its shame for the joy that was set before him. Jesus could look through the suffering, through the pain, through the difficulty to the glory that God had for him. That's what passion over comfort's all about. We're willing to step into the pain. We're willing to step into the discomfort. We're willing to step through the suffering because of the promise of God that's on the other end of that. Look through it. Don't try to look around it or above it. Look through it. That's exactly what Jesus did. And that's why every time Jesus talks about his death, he keeps reminding his disciples, but I'm coming back. That's not the end of the story. Passion over comfort means we are willing to suffer for Jesus because we know that's not the end of the story. Because here's the truth, and this is the final one. Passion over comfort is where life is found. Jesus said, whoever loses his life, their life, for me will find it. Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 10, the thief comes to steal, to kill, and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and life abundant. If we want to enjoy, if we want to experience the abundant life that God has for us, we need to be willing to lose our own life for him. That's what passion over comfort's all about. And I get it. It's uncomfortable. Ironic. It's difficult. But that's what we have to do. The more we try to hold on to and claim the life that this world has to offer, boy, when we get before Jesus someday, we're going to end up losing it all. This is it, right after this passage, and that's why I said read all the way through verse 28. This is where Jesus said, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and yet forfeit his own soul? But when we are willing to suffer for Jesus, following after him, laying our life down, surrendering to him, that's where we will find real and abundant life. That's where we find the life that God has for us. That's what passion over comfort is all about. Will you pray with me right now? Father, I thank you for the passion of Jesus Christ, Lord. Jesus came to this earth and he lived a poor man's life. God, there's nothing wrong with having money and having comforts of this world. I don't think there's anything wrong with that, Father. I think Jesus enjoyed comforts at different times. He enjoyed a good meal. He enjoyed fellowship around the fire. But those things weren't what directed his steps. What directed his steps was the mission that you had called him to. He was willing to suffer death on a cross so that my sins could be forgiven. He was willing to take the death that I deserve. It says in Romans, for the wages of sin is death. He was willing to take the death that I have earned, and out of his free, amazing, abundant gift, he was willing to give me his own life so that I could be counted righteous before you, God. And it's not just for me, Lord. We know Paul told Timothy that it's God's will, it's God's desire that all of mankind should be saved. So God, if there's a person in this room or watching online right now that's never taken that first step, even though it might be uncomfortable for them, they've never taken that first step of surrender, that first step of laying their lives down so that they could find real, true, abundant life in you. God, I pray right now is their moment. If that's you, you're watching online right now, or you're sitting in this room and you want to receive Jesus, you want to ask Jesus into your life, you want to surrender your life to him, just pray this prayer with me. Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. Please come into my heart and be the Lord of my life. It's such a simple prayer. God, I pray that you will use our church to go from this place. There is so much opportunity, Lord, around us, and so much need around us. We live in a nation that needs revival, God. Help us to be a people that will depend on you in prayer, but will also take those steps, those uncomfortable steps that might cause us some suffering. Help us to take those steps because of the passion that we have for you, to follow in your steps, to take up our cross, and to follow you for the joy that you have set before us in Jesus Christ. Help us to be a church where our attitude as a people is passion over comfort. We love you so much, God. I thank you for the good things that you've given us, the blessings that you've given us. Help us also, Lord, to be willing to step into the uncomfortable so that others can experience those same blessings. And the greatest blessing of all is to know Jesus as Lord, to have that same hope and assurance and promise. We love you, God, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen.